Welcome, everybody, to the Reality Report. It's Sunday, June 24th, 2018. This is Paul McGinley, co-host here in Toledo, Ohio, live. I'm here with my co-host, Brian Weinstein, in Bridgeton, New Jersey. We've got Reece Dodd back with us from Edmond, Oklahoma, the proud home of Scott Pruitt, I believe. And Brian can confirm that or deny it.
Former attorney general, not governor. I'm sorry.
Okay. So we want to continue with this discussion of UBI, universal basic income. We started it last Friday. I thought it was Reece brought up some wonderful points, and we can actually go deeper into this subject. Reece, what do you want to start on this? What did we leave out kind of, or where did we leave off? Maybe might be the more cogent question.
Well, I mean, we kind of touched the surface of UBI and how it's perceived currently in society at the populist level. But there's definitely, when you say deeper, like I said, this idea has been around for a really long time. And there's been a lot of great minds that have pondered it and found or tried to find ways for us to be able to utilize it. Last time we talked about Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., you know, he championed a guaranteed income for the people based on the percentage of GDP that the nation was worth, something that locked them in above the poverty line consistently, no matter what happened with inflation or GDP growth. A gentleman by the name of Buckminster Fuller, around in the 50s and 60s, was looking at the social situation, particularly us coming out of World War II, going through the Korean War, and then advancing into the Vietnam War within, you know, a two-decade period. He was looking at the finances being spent not just by his own country, but by countries around the world, financing the creation of death. I mean, that's what war is, the creation of death. And said if those same finances were applied to the creation of life, putting infrastructure into society, subsidizing certain aspects of society to make them cheaper and cheaper and cheaper, basically flood the market of supply and demand with abundance, and drive prices way down in the areas that you're trying to help society garner resources in. And then even the futurist Jacques Fresco, who's with a place called the Venus Project, he has all sorts of drawings and ideas and imaginings of what a life or world might look like if we did apply those finances to research and development of society. You know, you talk about military budgets annually of $600 billion. I mean, have you ever seen a $100 million combine?
Yeah, that's been bumped up, by the way. So yeah, let's review where our money is going right now. I mean, it's going to a state of perpetual warfare involving, I would say, amorphous Middle Eastern allies, dubious allies, and enemies.
It's a worldwide picture. It's not just, you know, our finances. This is the world's finances.
Yeah, understood. But we still lead the world as far as the military expenditure. It's not even close, apparently. Not even close. You know, in fact, I even have some figures here if given time. But anyway, Buckminster Fuller, you know, it's interesting because you mentioned he was 50s, 60s. And, you know, this must have been the backdrop of a successful rebuild of Europe, a successful rebuild of Japan, erstwhile enemies during World War II. So, you know, he came, I guess, from a period that believed in that we could actually rebuild nations. So very interesting. You go ahead while I continue looking for these figures that I'm.
And so whether it's Dr. King or Buckminster Fuller or the Venus Project, what a lot of these idealists or people that are trying to push this notion forward, not based on current practical reality, because if we try to agree how to apply this thing to current practical reality, we're going to have so many holes in the system, because there's already so many holes in the system that it's going to be hard to implement the system. But what these people did is they took it a step further and said, okay, if we were applying budgets this way, maybe it would look like this. And what they ended up coming up with was a resource-based economy, where they are providing the basic needs or infrastructure of society, things that we talked about last time, food, water, shelter, clothing, energy, technology, transportation, basically everything a human needs in our current day and age. These people were imagining paradigm shifts, societal shifts, towards a way of using our intelligence and technological advancement and finances to basically purchase a grand scale for society to grow upon.
Yeah, brilliant stuff. Absolutely brilliant stuff. So the question is, how viable could this be and how do we start? I'm still looking for that those figures. I mean, I can tell you right off that we just increased our defense budget to $716 billion. The bill just passed by an overwhelming, may I say, vote of 85 to 10, which means there's only 10 people in the is it the Congress or just the Senate? I don't know offhand right away, but I think it's Congress. 85 to 10. So only 10 people voted against any increase in the military-industrial complex. I don't know. That tells me that our leaders are just bought by military lobbyists. Pretty disappointing, I think. I'll go ahead and look for more information as to how much more we spend. To me, America should lead the way on this. Mm-hmm. Okay? Rediversion of military dollars to social programs. I think America should lead the way on this, being by far the world's largest military spender.
Right. Well, I mentioned last week, by the way, gentlemen, that I believe it was in the 1930s, Smedley Butler, who was probably the most decorated Marine in American history, at least up until World War II, had written a book called War is a Racket. I actually have it on Kindle somewhere, and you can get it free. So if you're out there, you're a subscriber on our YouTube or our Facebook channel, it doesn't cost you anything. I've read some of it from what I remember of it. It was, I mean, I don't know if it's enlightening, but he just generally brought up the point that most of the nations will ally themselves with each other to have some financial gain. And he mentioned how, for example, in World War One, how a lot of corporations made so much money. So, I mean, it's probably nothing groundbreaking by reading that, but it's basically along the same lines it's always really been, is that war has been a profit-making institution for many countries. And of course, you want to win the war because that's the whole point. If you're able to get their territory, then you can reap the benefits of it. But
A lot of the wars were over resources, imperialism, colonization, the hijacking of countries from
absolutely native peoples.
All these things were in the name of resources. And so one of the things I love about the resource-based economy is it tries to turn this around without trying to maybe even convince the situation that it's bad for itself, but goes to the heart of what all these things are about, and that's resources. And it tries to find a way to promote a society through the proper allocation and use of resources. And using resources the right way is maybe we could call efficiency, but the more efficiency your resource use is, the cleaner your resource acclimation is, the better you are going to be to be harvesting things from your environment. You're not going to be destroying the ecologies. And then if you're really efficient with those resources, you'll be able to take care of more and more and more business or people or whatever you want to call it with those resources. And so resource-based economies are really trying to promote this idea that if we look at how we get resources, provide them and use them, or not even provide them, allocate them, and then use them once allocated, that we could actually find ways to shortcut some of these things. We want to talk about finances on a $600 billion scale. We just said we don't know if we'd even need that much. if we were doing these things the right way? And how do you start changing the market? And everybody gets into all these complex financial things that go on right now. At the bare bottom of an economy, you have supply and demand. And if you can have resource extraction and allocation to where you flood so much supply onto the market that it makes it pennies on the ton, then you've essentially subsidized the market. And we do this with corn so we can produce super cheap sugars, and we pay off corn farmers and so on and so forth. We already subsidize things like the oil industry and agricultural industry and, heck, even the military industry. We subsidize all these things. But if we want to start a change, we got to take the market back. And you got to make something that we're using so worthwhile as a resource that those other resources don't matter. And you have to create so much of it, and you got to do this in a way that's not going to destroy the earth, but you got to create so much of it, you got to be able to give it out to 8 billion people. So that means you have to create more than you need.
As you say, I mean, the 600 billion would be more than enough, especially when doing this in concert with other nations. But I did get that figure. Apparently, this is on the old military budget. U.S. spends $610 billion annually. That has been subsequently boosted for 2019 to another 85-plus billion. But anyway, that $610 billion was more than China, Russia, Saudi Arabia, India, France, U.K., who is a big exporter, and Japan all put together. So I think the U.S. really needs to lead the way on it, being by far the champion at spending on defense. We need to go to this resource-based economy system, absolutely. And what's in greater need right now than basic foodstuffs? I mean, we've got rampant drought going on in large parts of the world. So the time is now. And unfortunately, we only saw 10 people in our Congress who saw the light and who were actually unfettered by these lobbyists and were able to vote against this bill. It's not looking good right now, Reece and Brian.
Paul, I don't know if you have the list there, but those 10, were they all Democratic senators?
Yes, I believe they were.
I'd assume that, right?
Well, there were some independents, too, I think.
Alan King? King or whatever.
Right. None of them were Republicans. No, they're all bought. Not all Alan of them. King, all of them bought.
Well, but on the other side of the aisle is 85.
Yeah, so most of the Democrats actually voted for the military increase. Yeah, so we're not seeing any relief from either party, really. The big names, Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders, I mean, the two that are, have their names linked to reform, I mean, they voted solidly against it, of course.
It's Angus King. Was Angus King one of the 10?
I'll have to go to the other article. I've got the list of who voted for as opposed to those who voted against. I've got all the Democrats. Let's see if Angus King was in there. No, yeah, he must have been because he didn't vote for it.
Right, he's from Maine.
Yeah. Yeah, I said, I believe there was... The independents voted against it. Feinstein voted against, Gillibrand of New York, Kamala Harris, Mike Lee, Ed Markey, Jeff Merkley, Rand Paul. Rand Paul, can you believe it?
Well, I can see Rand Paul. He's kind of a maverick in his own way.
Elizabeth Warren and Ron Wyden. Mm-hmm. And King joined them.
Right. But there are a lot of Democrats in the military.
Well, it says King joined an early United GOP caucus in approving the measure. Mm-hmm. Okay. But so 38 Democrats and Angus King actually joined nearly every Senate Republican Monday to pass the $716 billion defense bill. So we're going in the opposite direction here. Okay. This is not the right direction. Now we need a turnaround.
And, well, this is probably what what Reece has been saying about, and what you've been saying, Paul, about starting from the ground up, because you may not get any movement. And I'm sure, Reece, you could chime in on this, but it's obviously something that has to be ground up to make some change. And by the way, Reece, you mentioned it. Could anybody who's watching this get a firm grasp of what you're talking about as far as resource-based economy through a Venus Project website? Is that possible?
Yeah, they can just Google search the Venus Project.
Venus Project.
It'll take them straight there.
Okay.
I mean, this was just one man's ideas. I'm just saying he was a contributor to this futurist look of a resource-based economy and what could go into it. But who's to say what is practical and applicable? You know, we can sit here and dream about these things all day, but getting, you know, our senators or congressmen to vote on putting things like this forward. Paul, you said that the U.S. should lead the military reversal of taking the budget and putting it towards life creation. Getting these these factions to do those things in 2018 specifically, that sounds like a monumental task in and of itself, let alone creating an entire system where we can create this efficiency and balance.
Well, I would say we got to start by overturning Citizens United. I mean, that's where the evil monies are coming from.
That's exactly what I was going to chime in and get myself, because one of our sister sites, Reece, Paul knows, is Allied for the American Promise, which is a group of people who have gotten together at the local level across the country to fight Citizens United. And what they do is they don't go after the very conservative congressmen. They try to find the more moderate Republican congressmen, and they try to see if they get any type of meeting with them, just be able to be heard at first, because you have to get that. For example, our group met with Frank Lobiondo, who is a congressman from South Jersey. That'll be it for him this year. He automatically told us that, look, I can tell you right now, unless you can get the majority of my constituents, you know, on board here, I'm not going for something like this. And I think through all this work, I mean, which I think is the proper thing to do, you start at the local level. They did get one person, one Republican who was moderate, to say that he would sign off on something like this, you know, to keep money out of politics. But it's very, very difficult. But at least I think, I don't know what you would say, Reece, is that in this type of situation, you really have to start grassroots and go local. Would you agree with that?
I mean, I think you have to, if it's going to be for the people, it has to be by the people. And that's at the bottom of the food chain or hierarchy that you're talking about, grassroots. Mm-hmm. That's the people, just the ground level, yeah. The people that don't run any of this stuff. The people that society's for. You know?
Now, besides food, Reece, on this resource-based economy, would we be including services such as education, healthcare, things like this? Would we be including that?
I mean, I think you have to structure society in a way that's best for the health of the planet and the people. So, yeah, health care and earth care and education.
We forget about that so easily, earth care.
The amount of education that comes through the Internet nowadays. So getting people interested in finding out, you know, really basic scientific things that can help them see why it's important in their community, whether you're talking about Flint, Michigan, or other places that have been destroyed by polluted surroundings. You know, people that lived around Chernobyl in the 80s probably didn't like that whole experience. But, you know, getting the people to realize that taking care of their society, their family, their bodies, their ecosystem around them, the earth in general, I think that's what grassroots really is getting them on board with going, yeah, this is a really great thing for me, my family, my children, my neighbors, my community, my friends, my family. And if they can agree at that level, I think the other people around them will also be seeing the same thing, the groups that they just mentioned.
And if we can sand down, so to speak, you know, these basic inequities, inequality between citizens, perhaps we could also weaken racial animosity and class animosity and so on. Wasn't that part of Dr. King's theme? That this natural competitiveness which separates us, wouldn't that be attenuated by everybody having equal access to basic education, housing, food, healthcare?
Yeah, so I think when you provide all the base structural needs of a human being's life, you do that for everybody on the planet, you start the big societal race over. You're not asking anybody to give anything up. You're not asking anybody to get anything taken away from them.
Yeah.
But you give everybody an opportunity to start at the starting line. Mm-hmm. Whereas, you know, with European conquistadors coming over and taking the native lands, mm-hmm. and then importing slaves from other countries,
right.
Even when those bonds were broken, the race wasn't started over.
No.
And they were put down on a lower pedestal. So, I mean, you got to have everybody at the starting line at the same time. I think a universal basic income based on resources that are the basic human needs would be wonderful for what you're asking about, relations between classes and nations and races. I think it destroys the borders and barriers that do divide us.
We could keep the basic capitalist system, but just take away the exploitive nature of our current brand of capitalism. I mean, if everybody has a basic substance, like let's say foodstuffs come in the form of portions of flour, portions of eggs, portions of all this stuff. And if you're a little wealthy, you can go on and buy a little more, something a little bit fancier. And this could apply in each of the categories which will be provided on a basic level. So perhaps there's still room for the greedy, I don't want to say exploitive, we don't want that anymore, but the greedy form of capitalism that our countrymen so much love. Perhaps there could still be some room for that within the UBI framework.
I think that capitalism is a great metaphor. I mean, there's a lot of things from capitalism, industrialism, progressivism that can be taken as kind of like a highlight reel. And one of the things that capitalism has done since it's progressed through the Industrial Revolution for the last 200 years is that it has honed in on mechanization and efficiency and automation and mm-hmm. negation of cost and surplus of supplies and
growth and more growth, you know, and that's
I think there's certain things when you look at how a company works with the agricultural community to purchase millions of tons of flour. You brought up flour. Get that flour weighed out and bagged and shipped all over.
Rice, everything, yeah.
I mean, you're talking about some really efficient systems that have very, very little waste, and they've only gotten better and better and better with automation and mechanization as time has gone on.
And you've excised the middlemen out, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Some of the metaphors of capitalism are what it showed us to be able to do with resource acclimation and resource allocation and efficiency and international transport. Mm-hmm. I mean, these are the things that we're going to want to use in our new system if we're talking
about can borrow those,
all 8 billion people.
Yeah, an exploitative side, you can keep that. We don't want it anymore. Yeah, absolutely.
And we had plenty of that, of course. We don't have to go too deeply into it, but even we talk about the Industrial Revolution. I suppose Guy McPherson, that we're really talking about 1750. You're talking about, you know, 200-300 years of slavery to help you really get from one point to another rather quickly. Now, I agree with you, Reece, that the distribution function of capitalism has been streamlined, and that should be taken from it. I don't have a lot of confidence in the way the system's done. Neither does Paul, obviously.
Because it was more than just the slaves, you see. I mean, then they exploited children, child labor,
right,
in the
right.
Gilded Age. Then they exploited women. Now they're exploiting the two. We've always exploited immigrants. We still are undocumented immigrants. We're businesses have been exploiting them. We're now exploiting the two income family. I mean, it's never ending. I mean, capitalism needs to grind these people up in their wheels, you know, their turbines, and just grind them up, you know, for more profits for the few. We definitely need to relook at the whole system, Reece, and I love what you're proposing here as a starting point. Absolutely.
Well, you brought up some major shifts there, but I think the one thing to highlight, I think this is what Dr. King was hitting upon, was that the exploitation never stopped.
Never.
Groups of people might have got a small break here and there, but the
but it's endemic in the system. Yeah.
Of everything is not stopped. And this is what a hierarchy that resides on exploitation produces, is exploitation at the societal level. Mm-hmm. And so, I mean, if we create a system that take care of everybody like one big family, and I don't think you have exploitation in something like that. And we're talking about getting rid of the exploitive side of the current market system. So what you're talking about essentially is getting rid of greed. How do you get rid of a greed? The only way I know is abundance. Abundance is the only way that I can know to get rid of it.
Or the path where you can actually express your greed lead nowhere. There's no envy or
I guess I should say freely accessible abundance.
Well, you're basically, are you saying just having a supply that's so high that it drives down the price makes it more difficult for businesses?
Well, your 5 pounds of food is the same as my 5 pounds of food, and there's going to be 5 pounds of food tomorrow. Mm-hmm. What would you ever get from taking my 5 pounds of food on a Tuesday?
Well, right. I mean, somebody might want caviar, and they can pay extra for that. But
no, I see what you're basically saying, like a kid at school wants to get a drink of water. The next student's not going to be upset when he gets a drink of water. Now, if there's only one bottle of Coke in the room, maybe there's going to be a fight over it. But
right.
I think that's what you're saying.
Yeah. Yeah, the water fountain, water fountain is abundance, and it is freely accessible. Right. So, yeah, I think that's exactly what I'm talking about. And, you know, we have a fighter plane that's worth $15 million in our Air Force. A lot of research and development and time went into that, and then a lot of costs go into producing that. Have you ever seen the research and development on a $15 million?
Must be. There's so much intelligence built into that machine that there has to be so much involved along down the line. It's just incredible.
Oh, yeah, the cost of the machine is $15 million, but I can't imagine what the research and development.
Because it has to. You have to really go way back there, Reece. Not just the cost of the actual aircraft, but you know the cost of educating those who are going to get to the point where they can do such things. The cost is incredible, absolutely incredible.
Yeah, so I'd like to see what a $15 million farming combine can do for industrial agriculture.
Right.
We don't have anything like that. We max them out at a certain point. I'm sure there's a $15 million farming combine, but you're talking about years and piles of research and development and finances. What is $400 million into research and development on a farming combine look like to produce a $15 million farming combine?
Right.
So.
And Reece, you, I think this is all the more important what you say, because we've had Guy McPherson on as a guest, and he like many people, believe that the population is going to explode to somewhere around 10 billion on the Earth. So we may almost be forced into something like this, wouldn't you think?
I think we're currently being forced into it, but yeah, as future goes on, more and more so. I think the inequality and the downtrodden are being shown, whether it's the politicians being killed south of us, or the journalists being killed internationally, or the massive dictatorships that now run the developed world.
Less arable land, the desertification of the planet with global warming, it makes it even more difficult. So what you're saying is even more impressive, in my opinion.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the and actually, Brian, the UN studies project human population at 12 to 14 billion at the end of the century before it starts dropping again.
Okay, so here's the deal. In my mind, if we're going to create a resource-based economy, we need it to be based around something that is good for the planet. But not only good for the planet, we can produce so much of it as a resource. When we do grow to 12 or 14 billion, we can produce 16 billion's worth of it, because that's the only way you get to abundance, right?
Right.
More than you need. Well, but if we create an extra 2 billion people's worth of resources, they either better be infinite resources, which we don't have any infinite resources as of right now, and they better not be damaging to the planet, because if you got 2 billion people's worth of waste just laying around, you're going to strip mine your planet faster than you ever could. And that's what finite resources do. Not only do we spend a lot of energy, getting them, they're not very good for the ecosystem in their mining, their refinement, or their usage. The hard thing is oil's been our energy explosion for the last 150 years. It bootstrapped off of what coal did for the energy industry, which far outpaced the timber energy industry. So, I mean, we've constantly found these new resources to try to boost our growth. The problem with traditional energy resources is they can do lots of things, and that's what we love about them. But there's one thing that they can't really do. You can't eat oil or coal or even timber energy for that fact. But the one thing we really do love about these energy explosive energy supplements that we've been shaping our society with is that they have byproducts that we can also use. That's the number one thing we love about oil, is it's not just oil. It's not just energy. It is so many other things. It's nylon, it's fertilizers, it's pesticides, it's plastics.
Polyesters.
It's 75% of what we use in society. Everything is injected, molded plastic now. It's in our technologies, it's in our laptops, it's on our computers, our cell phones. Oil is everywhere, and that makes it even better than coal, because we have all these secondary refinements and third-level refinements to get resources out of it. But the problem with oil is, once again, is it environmentally destructive as it is, it's a finite resource.
Right.
So even if we found the best way to use it, we're eventually going to run out. And so then we're kind of left at this crux of, well, what do we do that's better than oil? What is there that could be better than oil, other than, you know, renewable resources, which those only go so far? They don't have secondary products. You don't get nylon t-shirts out of wind power.
Right.
You don't get fertilizer for the agricultural fields from solar power.
Right. There's just so much energy in oil. They say you get a teacup of oil can lift a ton. You know, there's just so much energy, and it's hard to beat right now.
Well, the one resource that really cannot be replaced is water, and it's got to be foremost in our plans to preserve what we've got.
That's why the smart people, a couple in the last decade, especially out here in oil country in Oklahoma, were not buying up land for leases or drilling. They were buying up giant water reserves in Mr. Pickett.
Because it's more valuable than oil.
Oh, yeah, who runs the campus of OSU at this point with his donations.
Even
on a widespread buyout of Oklahoma and Texas and in the regional area of places that had massive stores of water.
But this is why it's critical to save our oceans. I mean, we're already close to the point of no return. We've got these microplastics all over the oceans being digested by marine life and so on. And we have to start that cleanup now. And we could use some of that military budget to start doing this.
Well, land, water, and air. We're degrading our oceans.
Oh, yeah. It's all of it.
we're degrading our air with our CO2 expulsion and what it's doing to the climate, and we're destroying our land with our massive amount of pesticide and herbicide and fertilizer use and industrial agriculture that has basically strip mined the top layer. And it's funny that all life on this planet owes its being to 6 inches of topsoil and a little bit of rain.
Right.
Well, apparently these simple truths are lost on the part of the 85 who voted to extend the military, to extend the system of death, as you call it. And I certainly would agree with that. It's very, very disappointing. We're going to have to turn this ship around now. I mean, we're heading to that iceberg, and it's time to turn it around now. Maybe it's got to be done by the grassroots, Reece, but first step is teaching us all about this, and we appreciate you doing it. It has to
be done by the grassroots.
You know, the comedian Doug Stanhope, as much as he's a comedian, he's a very intelligent man. He mentioned in a few of his videos that the number one enemy for all of this problem with the use of resources really is a limiting population, that we have to, at some point, people have to decide to limit the population. In fact, a lot of uneducated people tend to have more children than the educated. You'll see places like Japan, Scandinavian countries, they're usually only having one or two children and doing well doing that. I can't see any of this becoming effective unless there's some idea of population control. I'm not necessarily saying anti-natalism at this point, but that has to figure in, because each human being is just a heat-consuming engine, as Guy would say, and it's a big issue.
You should watch a little short documentary called "Don't Panic: The Truth About Population" by Hans Rosling. He's a Swedish guy, but he shows that not only have births per family been going down internationally since 1963, but the population has been rising at faster and faster rates. Now, the median family children average internationally is 2.5. In 1963, it was 5. And so we've halved the average family child birth by half in the last 55 years. But at the same time, since 1963, we've gone from 3 billion to 7.4 billion people. So, right. I mean, it's not even just the large families. I mean, the average family, even in a place like Bangladesh, which 40 years ago was at like 7 or 8, is now at 2.2 in 2016. Yep. Very interesting documentary. Check it out.
Right, but right.
I think that if we're worried about consuming all of our finite resources, heck yeah, you got to be worried about population size. If we're looking at a population of 7 billion and saying our resource usage is destroying our planet, and you try to project that in the future, I think the only mindset you could have is to say, well, if we can't find our magic technology to fix this, we're going to have to lessen our population. But I think in reality, if our act was cleaned up, if we put our finances in the right places, and we were taking care of our people and the planet in the way science has shown us that we can already, then, I mean, I don't see why we couldn't host 30 billion people on this planet. But, I mean, we're going to have to be doing the complete opposite of what we're doing now.
So the start is a building of a new cooperative, collective consciousness instead of this.
I think the start is an infinite resource. And we haven't harnessed our infinite resources such as solar and wind and water. And those have been the most infinite things for us. But in the grand scheme of capitalism, the growth of industrialization, we've seen things on massive scales the size of oceans. I mean, if you could see the cornfields of the Midwest, it's the size of some other countries. It's the size of small ocean. But the only thing that is infinite on this planet for us is our plants. It's the only thing we know that we can manipulate to some of the highest numbers, until we get to numbers that get so high we cut back and don't want to do it anymore. We pay farmers not to farm corn. because it would exacerbate the supply and demand of the market if all the corn farmers grew farm.
And that's where the SNAP program grew and why it was connected to the Farm Bill, because that's what they did with their surpluses.
There's 450 million acres of arable land in the United States. That's land that is able to be farmed.
For now.
Not used in cities, but not, you know, available to be farmed. And we farm 330 million of it. So there's 120 million acres not being farmed. So there is room for more plants, but we have yet to find a perfection of plants for us to be able to use them as anything more than food. We've yet to find a way to use them as energy. We've yet to find a way to use them as plastic. We use some of them for clothing. But for the most part, we have a misunderstood connection with the earth, its ecosystem, and its plant life. And at the fringe areas of technology and advancements, we see things like plant-based plastics coming forward. We know some of the best biodiesels that were ever made came from plants, and that the diesel engine was built around the notion that it would be run by biodiesel, not by oil diesel. And so I think that plants and our land usage and how we go about things and not toxifying our systems may give us an opportunity to create infinite resources for the people of the planet.
Let's not forget, and Paul knows where I stand on this, that as we've spoken with Guy McPherson, no matter how much arable land we have, or it wouldn't be arable at this point, but at 104 degrees, photosynthesis doesn't occur, and that's still going to be an issue as more and more arable land potentially becomes parched. Even in the United States, there are studies that show from 2030 to 2060, much of the United States is going to become parched.
We need a massive CO2 vacuum. Right. And what is the most massive CO2 vacuum there is? Plants.
We need to start now.
We need to start now. Absolutely. That's the thing. You know, I mean, we're dawdling by increasing military bills and channeling further dollars towards the few. I mean, it's time. We need to start now. That's why it's great having you on, Reece, because we've really got to get this out.
And Reece is, I guess, Reece, you're a millennial, obviously. It'll be those people. You know, you are the ones that are really going to have to change what we've screwed up, because I used to blame it on my parents' generation all the time, but now it's just us because we've benefited from it. But you'll have to fix it. I don't know what else. I mean, we'll be there with you.
I mean, I think every generation. We're all just children on this planet. If you look at the way society's run, is it run like a responsible adult? And what I would term a responsible adult is someone who can take care of themselves, provide all the resources they need for life. But a responsible adult can take care of their own life and have enough resources left over to take care of other life. An adult might be able to take care of themselves, but a responsible adult can take care of other life.
Right.
And if you look at the way society is run, it's run like a high school. There's cliques, and there's popularity contests, and there's an abuse of hoarding of wealth and resources. And some kids got it good, and some kids got it bad. Society's high school, man. It's a continuation.
Right.
So when I look at the generations, whether it's the ones below me, the one I'm in, or the ones above me, we're all just children on this world. You brought up God a couple of times. I feel like that's kind of along his lines. We are children. We are just children. We don't have an understanding. We're just constantly floundering. But if you look at history, of all the abuses that we've done to ourselves and to others, nation after nation, race after race, time and time again, all of history is one big story of abuse. It's still
exploitation.
It's still a scaffolding that we've been continuing to build upon and try to perfect and try to correct and try to take back some of the abuse that's been done and try to provide reparations and provide better ways of life for people from what they had before. And I don't think that us moving forward is anything less than that.
Well, it's very refreshing to see your optimism, Reece. I mean, if anything's going to be done, if it can, I'm not so sure. I'm an optimist in this situation because I'm kind of in Guy McPherson's thinking. But I think it's great, because if there is a way out, it'd be people like you who are going to do it. with that
More than optimism, it's got to be a demand.
You know,
we have to demand that this be done. There's no other way. And we're running out of time, obviously. Mm-hmm. I mean,
guys, to get this done. We're kind of at a part where I feel like we got to do one more. And, I mean, it can be a week from now or 2 weeks from now, but we built up to what I feel like there's a climax here that we haven't gotten to.
The subject is deep and rich, and I would love to. When I said I was running out of time, I was more referring to as a society we've run out of time. But also we've also kind of towards the end here as well.
Because we might leave for exactly where we want to go next time.
Yeah. Right. So yeah, let's we'll have a part three on this. Absolutely. I think it's an important subject and. We just can't discuss it enough, really, in my opinion.
Can I finish by reading a little something?
Absolutely.
That I wrote on this topic. Somebody had posted something about universal basic needs, universal basic resources in a universal basic income forum. And a lot of the people in the comments section wanted to talk about the finances, the practicality, the reality. How do we do this? Isn't it going to make people lazy? You know, a lot of the questions that we've already brought up in the 2 hours that we've talked about it. And so I'd like to read this real quick. As opposed to trying to figure out how it's going to be implemented, because I don't think we'll ever agree on how it's going to be implemented or how we should apply it to current society. I would just like to say that these ideas are what society needs. If we focus on how to apply it to current societal settings, like I said, I don't know if we'll ever agree how to get there. What is being discussed is a completely new way of allocating resources and progressing society with technology. It cannot be termed by any previous names. It cannot be compared to any previous system. There are other points in history where this has happened. An example would be democracy. And we brought that up on the last show. Like when it was being created, you couldn't apply previous terms to it. It was something completely new. And what we're talking about here, what Dr. King was talking about, what Buckminster Fuller was talking about, is a completely new thing of running society. What is being redefined is basic human needs. What is necessary for life and how it should best be available for the population of the planet. In systems that define causes such as oversupplying goods to abdicate demand through abundance, producing and consuming resources in ways that are environmentally healthy, depreciating a financial hierarchy that currently controls the resources, rations them on the market for profit, and finds way to abuse the populace as it pillages them, have nothing to do with words like socialism and communism. In our own words, we proclaim that we are interested in providing life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Life no longer means just existing on this planet. Our advancements in science, medicine, technology have shown that life is much, much more. It needs a lot of support to be successful. It needs things like water, food, and shelter. Even animals need these things. Human life needs clothing and energy. Societal life needs transportation and technology communication. If we can provide these things for, let's say, military personnel, which is done systematically to reduce financial stress, and we do so across the world systematically when war machines were ramped up in the last world war, in great number of supplying dozens of millions, who is to say that we could not find a system that secure life for all and do it in a financially feasible way of supply and demand markets? Liberty is what life is when all the basic needs of life are supplied. It gives one freedom to be. If a human does not have to worry about food on the plate, water in the cup, house overhead, clothes on back, energy for warmth and production, transportation to move freely, and technology to connect and communicate, they have the liberty to be themselves. The pursuit of happiness is what children have, for they are provided all the above things listed, at the hope that they will flourish and become their best being. A true pursuit of things that make them happy. Even in strictly rationed and controlled societies, the pursuit is most evident in the children. Even in a life of abused poverty, this happiness is most evident in the children. They are given freely resources to grow and live, and they are not quite realizing of the drabness of the life situation they have been handed. They still have the hope of life. They are provided with everything they need or given liberty, and they live in the pursuit of joy. A system that provides universal basic needs, the things we all need and take for granted that supply us life, will be like unlike anything the world has ever seen before, but only for the adults. We all experienced this system as children, for we could not care for ourselves. Not all of us got the best of this system as children. There are still places in every country over the world that suffer the abuse of poverty and lack of needs. But as children, we did not know any different and pursued happiness until we came to the realization of what life was when we were thrust into adulthood of society, when we started to have to take care of our own life. A system that provides universal basic human needs, that is repairing to the earth and its ecosystems, that is given freely to every human's needs, is the only society that it can equally be called for all life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Or quite simply, being free.
Yes. Let's return to the childhood state. Absolutely agree. Very well. Very well written.
Sorry, I stumbled a couple of times.
No. But
thanks, guys, for having me. I love doing this.
We're going to be back on. We'll be back on again. We'll be in touch regarding a follow-up time. Mm-hmm. And if
you're
available,
on YouTube also, so don't. This is not only Facebook. This will also be on YouTube.
Yeah, if you're available midweek, I think we could possibly do another follow up.
Thank you very much, Reece.
Thank you.
For Reece Dodd in Oklahoma, Brian Weinstein in New Jersey, and Paul McGinley here in Ohio, we're signing off. Thanks for listening and watching.